It's time to talk cycling again. I'm going to get Leigh Hoffman on the screen. I haven't met him, never. I've spoken to him for all of 48 seconds in just recently, just to arrange this interview. And this is my background to him. Never met him, spoken to him for 48 seconds, watched him win a world title while I was streaming on the computer, and he was in near Paris in France and I was in Sydney. So I've seen him race the whole three laps of a velodrome. In other words, the opening lap for qualifying, the first round and the final of the World Championships. All of those rides were done in less than 42 seconds. And his final race in the final for the gold medal against the Dutch, the defending champions and the Olympic champions, he did a sub 17 second opening lap. And I don't know if anyone else has done that. Maybe he'll know about it. So we're going to talk team sprinting and talk about gold medals and world championships and fast times. And I'm just going to bring him into the video interview right now. The admin out of the way, the intro out of the way. And I'm about to meet a 20-year-old bike rider who's just won, as far as I know, he's done two races with the Australian cycling team, Commonwealth Games in Birmingham and the Worlds in France in 2022. Both times he won gold. So it's a pretty good record, isn't it? Track record. Not quite a world record yet, but going on the times that he's set and his youth and his teammates, we could expect that with Scott Gardner's help as head of the whatever Oz Cycling's called, the sprint group now, I reckon they're going to be challenging for world record, more gold medals, etc. We'll see what Leigh says. If you just got back from doing the shopping, I know that much. Here he is. So, without any delay, I'm going to introduce him to the stream. Hello, Leigh Hoffman. Nice to meet you.
How you going? Yeah, going all right. How about yourself?
Yeah, not too bad. Not too bad.
I like you got the box in the background. That looks good there.
Yeah, I mean, that's, well, yeah. All reversed, but that's my favourite cycling photo of all time, and no one's right. 1924, Col de Tourmalet, dirt road. They say gravel's the new thing, but it's old, you know.
Yeah. No, I like that. It's nice.
And then a road bike and a gravel bike.
Yeah.
But I don't have a fixie. I've got lots of bikes in the office.
Well, there's no practical application for a fixie, really. So
only going bloody fast and giving yourself
Yeah.
So hopefully you know that I've been following bike racing for a bloody long time, and I know a fair bit of track racing. So
yeah.
I also know that going faster than 42 seconds in a team sprint is unreal.
The only two teams to ever do it, Australia now and Netherlands.
And you did it three times in a space of about an hour. I don't know.
It wasn't very much. Hour and a half, basically. The scheduling's pretty... We were lucky with the scheduling, but at Olympics, it's actually worse. Like they love to just cram it in. And that's why every Olympics, people are always just blowing off the back. Like the third wheel, it's so brutal.
Okay, yeah, I did look at the Tokyo times. I noticed that the Australians qualified in a 42 low.
Yeah.
And then for the chocolate medal, they did a 44 or something like
that. Yeah, just blew apart, unfortunately. Yeah.
So, I mean, it's over in the blink of an eye, but there's a lot that goes into it. But I was up early, so I got to see it all unfold live in near Paris. And I was so impressed with the start technique, not only of the winning team, your team, your efforts and your sub 17 final, but everyone seems to be going technique perfect at the moment. But I think you were probably assisted by the fact that the Dutch had to do a restart. So was that a gate problem or a rider problem? Can you just clarify that for me?
So the Dutch's restart in their second ride, is that the one you're talking about? Was, I think they either stripped a cog or it was just a pulled wheel, which must be a factor that they have like it must be a shortcoming on their Koga frame, maybe. Like, it's pretty uncommon to get pulled wheels at competition these days. Like, where, like, for training, I can understand, like, we've got certain torque settings we want to put in there just so we're not breaking bolts and whatnot and stripping, like, bearings and stuff like that. But for racing, you're normally just chucking the, for, especially for a starter, you're wrenching that up pretty tight. So a pulled wheel is pretty uncommon. So I don't know if that's a mistake by their mechanic or whatnot, but I'm fairly sure it's just a pulled wheel.
But you guys, well, you did everything faultlessly. Like, in other words, got to the gate, got out of the gate, past times, one after the other. You're the starter.
Yeah.
And then Tom was in qualifying, and he was replaced with Matt Glaetzer.
Yep, for rides 2 and 3, Matthew Glaetzer rode.
Okay, that's it. And Matthew Glaetzer was always third, or with Tom and then him. And then Matthew Richardson was second wheel all the time.
Yep, for 3 rides, yeah.
Right. Okay. I've known Matt Glaetzer a little bit. I've not spoken with Matt Richardson, and this is the first time we've met. I did a little intro saying that I'd spoken to you for 48 seconds before going live with this interview.
Okay, sure.
But can we just do some basic numbers? Because not a lot of people, are probably following your track world record on Strava. Yeah, sure. Probably not uploaded. So
no.
Can we just go with your height? I'm gauging based on photos that you're similar to Matt Glaetzer.
So basically the same height as Matthew Glaetzer, 6'3", 190, maybe 91, I think, 191 centimetres, 190. Weight for me, my race weight for that day was 89.3 kilos. So I've done quite a bit to drop a little bit of kilos because I'm normally in general training and racing about the 93 kilo mark, but drop back a bit of calories, low res diet and stuff like that just to get the power to weight a bit more, like, higher. So yeah, race weight for me is about 89 kilos, which I'm lucky, like, I can sort of, I'm a bit of a chameleon with my weight. I can sort of go up and down when I need to be.
Is that because you're putting on bulk or putting on muscle or?
Yeah, so just for general training, it's like have a lot of lean muscle mass targets that we have to hit throughout the year. So obviously trying to bulk all the time. There's no real bulking phase. We're bulking basically every phase except for competition, really.
Mm-hmm. And is that largely protein powder, good old-fashioned eggs?
Basically for us, just lots of protein, always in a calorie surplus, like lots of carbs normally. Like per meal, I'm eating probably 130 grams of carbs per meal. So to get that big sort of surplus in, so we've got that big bank, which we can hopefully just keep adding to our muscle mass targets and whatnot. And fat mass doesn't really matter in general prep. It's when we get to racing, we naturally lean down because we're eating less. But yeah, fat-wise, I'd say a percentage-wise, I was probably around 8% at Worlds, probably maybe a little bit less, I'd say. Like, I was very lean, like quad veins, calf veins, rib veins, like just veins everywhere, basically.
Okay. So that's some of the physical stuff. The gearing that you raced in the final looked awful, looked heavy.
So I can't say the gearing's exactly, but for the first 2 rounds, I rode a bigger gear just to help things basically be a bit more smoother and a bit more delivery, and also for the boys not to be every ride they're really reaching to get on. So just rode a little bit of a bigger gear just to make it smoother. And then for the final, we said, all right, let's squeeze a little bit more out. Like, everyone's on the same page. We know we're going to drop my gear down. Richo and Glaetzer are going to stay a similar gear, but we just know that start's going to be a little bit more stressed. So yeah, dropped it down, I think maybe 2 teeth for the final. And then, yeah, so that's when the 16.9 happened.
Okay. So are you going to take a cue from that? Are you going to go smaller gear, or is it just the fatigue factor because you had one like race?
Well, yeah, like the thing is, I could, like, it sounds like a bit of a big head cocky thing to say. I can definitely go quicker than 16.9, but the thing is, for team sprint right now, it's not applicable because if I'm going, say, 16.8 or quicker, that means that the gear ratios in second and third will have to drop down to get onto me. Mm-hmm. So it's we can make up ground there, but it's going to affect the back end. So we don't really want to stress that enough, sort of thing, right now. That's something going ahead, like some planning that we have to do, is do we want to get more gains in lap one or more gains in lap three, where lap three is what it's all about, really. So I think for us, like a 16.9 and consistent 17.0 paces is perfect for our team sprint right now.
Okay. What's the record for the first lap? Is that yours?
So before it was sea level record is Ethan Mitchell at New Zealand, Rio 16.995. And the official world record is Renee Enders 2013 at Colombia, I think, or maybe Angus in the Mexico track, the altitude track. I can't pronounce it. Angus Villantes or something. A 16.994. So I've actually rectified both of those world records with 16.949, I think it was.
Yep.
So yeah, I've unified both of those world records and yeah, basically new world record holder, even though it's not an official world record because it's not an official event. It's like a world's official best time, really.
Yeah, it's bloody fast. I mean,
yeah.
I knew that if it was under 17, it was challenging for the fastest ever. Because you don't have the Olympic splits readily available.
Yeah.
Difficult to source. But can you, then... We talked about numbers. Can you give some wattage detail? Because not a lot of people could. I reckon that most strain.
So I can only estimate because for our three week training camp that we had at Bordeaux beforehand, and also for racing, we actually had Durace cranks on, which don't have power. Mm. So, like in training and stuff, I hit consistently say 2,300 on like a start lap. But then obviously that's only going at 17.3 paces in training. So then once you get to competition level, you can see like a pretty big increase of watts, probably by 10%, I'd say. So my PB watts is actually 2,512, I think. So that was hit in Glasgow World Cup in like a warm-up. So that was, say, 8 months ago. So for a 16.9 lap, On that gear, I'd probably say in the range of 2,600 plus, I'd say. It sounds ridiculous, but I'm backing myself. I'd say around that mark, 2,600 plus.
But you weren't racing with SRM or anything?
No. So the Durace cranks are just straight cranks. No power meter on, but they're super light is what we use, and stiff as well.
That's what you used in the final?
Yeah, we use them for all our racing now. Yeah.
Wow, okay. Current generation Durace?
They're kind of old. They're just like the old silver ones. Like you see them in photos and know the ones like that I'm talking about, yeah.
Yeah, I haven't got a lot of imagery from the world, but yeah. I sort of watched it live. But anyway, I'll try and track something down. But
yeah.
Yeah, okay, cool. And did you meddle with your tyre pressures, given that we've given the other numbers some...
Tire pressure is normally just around 200, like pretty standard for track, like 200, maybe even 180 just for a bit of handling and stuff.
Okay. Yeah. Have you fiddled around with pressures and width a lot on the track?
Widths, yes. We used to run the 19 mil tires, but we found that I think it's either 21 or 23 mil is just a bit better because the 19 mil is very like slippery for sprint and stuff when we're going slow doing the cat and mouse sort of style, like those tire widths, like you're racing on like something like that small, so like they're just not applicable. I'm pretty sure we've run the 21 or 23 mils now.
Okay. It looked like a good buzz. It looked like an exciting meeting. I mean, to watch Filippo Ganna is crazy. Unbelievable. To see him go sub four in competition a week after breaking the hour, that must have been, were you attracted? I've got goosebumps.
I was there in the crowd. Yes, sea level as well, like it's fucking crazy, honestly. Like that man is breaking barriers left, right and center, and I don't think he's going to stop anytime soon as well.
And to be frank, I mean, it's what he's doing, you know, not single-handedly, like he's won pursuits as well in fine style, but it's his kind of contributions that's bringing back the popularity of track cycling. It's going to serve you, I think.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Do Will we see you in sprint events, or you're just a time trialist to start?
Yeah. So this year, I think I've just had like a unfortunate year where for the lead up for the World Cup, I missed out on some points because of I had COVID at Oceania Championships, which we earned so much points. So then that just had a flow on effect. I didn't race Oshis. I didn't race the World Cup. And then I wasn't fit enough for commies. I could just only do start lap, which I was sort of locked into. And then obviously for Worlds, I just didn't qualify. So next year, I'm definitely going to have a big focus on sprint and Kieran.
Ah, cool. Okay.
Yeah.
And you feel, up to the task if you go head to head with someone like Matt Richardson? Will you be able
for sure. Yeah. I can't wait to race the other boys and give them a run. So okay. All the confidence in the world.
All right. Just talk to me a little bit about, Matt Glaetzer has got a very, very, very particular final lap style, I don't know how you call it, panther, I don't know.
Yeah.
Can you get that low? Is that?
So I think we're all pretty similar with our aero positions, but the reason they look so different is because of our proportions are different. So me and Glaetzer have been the same height. You'd think we'd look similar on a bike, but we don't, because he's actually got a longer back. So he has to elongate his back a lot more to get into his aero position, where mm-hmm. I've got like a bit of a shorter torso but longer legs. So we obviously, like, everyone's different with their aero positions, but similar from a CDA standpoint, we're all pretty dialed and in there. But we'll get some more testing sort of in the next 3 months for next season. We'll get some more testing. Hopefully we can. Matthew Richardson recently went to, I think, Silverstone to have some testing done, so hopefully when we go overseas the whole team can get done there as well.
Cool. With the handlebars, what are you on?
So I'm on the standard sort of Argon ones that they've made for us, the 32 centimeter bars. I do think the whole integrated stem is so much more stiffer and whatnot compared to a stem and a bar, but obviously they've still got to do some testing and stuff with even with the sprint bars as well.
But then if we could just round off, because I know there was a little change in management yesterday, and Scott Gardner's sort of, he's an old mate of mine from many years ago, but he's as far as I'm concerned, he's a wizard. He's a superstar of the track cycling world, and it must be a joy to work with someone like him. He was in France with you, was he? And did he have an impact on your performance?
Yeah, for sure. So Scott's been with us for a couple months now. Like, we've sort of only just got to know him and whatnot. But yeah, this trip, he's came away with us, and it's been good having him at the training camp and also at competition. Like, he's one of the most knowledgeable people that I've met with cycling, one of the most passionate people I've met, and it's awesome to have him on board. And I think he's got a lot of ideas that he can implement into our team, sprint team, and also sprint and Kieran, that can hopefully progress us to like an Olympic gold.
All right. Hey, super nice to meet you. Thanks for some insight.
Yeah, thanks.
Pass on my congrats to Tom, Matt and Matt. And
sure thing.
It is a thing of beauty. The team sprint, when it's done at the efficiency level that you guys did, like, that's clockwork.
I could talk
about it a bit longer, but I'm surprised that the layoff, for example, on the first lap, but it's all part of it now, isn't it?
Exactly right.
Yeah. Super duper. Thanks for chatting, man. And
all right, yep.
We'll stay in touch.
Yeah, easy. Yep. Thanks, Rob.
Ciao.